43, where here again we will talk about hypothesis testing, and we will go in detail regarding various hypothesis testing. And last class we had already discussed about one special example regarding hypothesis testing for testing whether a coin is a fair coin or unfair coin based on sample data. That means few observations. Based on 100 observations, we conclude that whether that coin was fair or not. So that inference we did it through one example. Here we will talk in detail that there are various approach to perform hypothesis testing. Among them, most famous one is what we are calling it two-sided hypothesis testing. That means where we are defining the significance level, what we are calling it, it is including two levels, both left side and right side we include in the significant level. That we are calling it rejection region. Rejection region coming both side, both tail side, right and left side. So that we will talk about. Also we will talk to introduce one p-value condition. What is the p-value condition? Again, it is talking about probability related with whether that it suggests towards rejection region or not in rejection region. So another that one is we had gone through alpha, that significant level what we are calling it. Another term that will come as a p-value, so we'll see that as well. So coming to outline of today's lecture, here first I would like to talk about two-sided hypothesis testing, and probably in next two-sided it is coming like this way. That means the pivot what we are defining, I told that there is a very good theory for a standard normal random variable. We can almost get value of the distribution function of normal random variable easily from the normal table. Also we can calculate probability. That's way here if you talk about a standard normal random variable, it is very much familiar to everyone and very easy to deal with due to a lot of work over a standard normal random variable. So this one is a story regarding a standard normal random variable. And similar kind of things, if it suppose we are going to estimate mean or variance or any kind of thing, suppose we are going to estimate mean, so in that process what we do, we come up with sample mean. Okay, and with this sample mean we are defining a new random variable q that happens to be a standardized normal, a standardized sample mean. That means x sample mean minus theta happens to be what we are parameterizing that sample mean. That mean what we that one is unknown to us. Theta is unknown to us. You can write it mu, but generally we are taking notation theta for parameter perspective. Till now we had already seen that there are two notation for parameter. Either we go with omega or we go with theta. In probability generally we go with theta. If you change your course like machine learning and other thing, in that case parameter we will denote it by omega in other courses, but in probability general notation is theta. And we deviate the sample mean by the true mean theta and divide it by the standard deviation of the what we call it sample mean. So a standard deviation of sample mean happens to be a standard deviation of the distribution divided by a square root of n. And suppose someone is saying that if n is not given, this sigma is not given, then that time also you can define a new pivot element like this way, x bar minus sample mean minus theta divided by a sample variance. In place of variance you can proceed with sample variance divided by a square root of n. So this is pivot, and this pivot is also having kind of distribution. It is approximately normal distribution. It is having approximately q is also having approximately normal distribution. That's why in confidence interval q is playing very important role. We had already seen the importance of q, this name of q what we are calling it pivot quantity or pivot random variable. by what quantity. We had already seen in while estimating interval. So same Q is playing very important role in hypothesis testing as well. So we will see that application of that one as well. So here I will talk a lot about two-sided hypothesis testing, then p-value, then I will go to talk about likelihood test. So first, coming to two-sided hypothesis testing, what is this and how we perform two-sided hypothesis for a unknown parameter? Generally mean, it happens to be mean. So how we can do hypothesis testing for this unknown parameter theta? Okay, so what we do here in two-sided hypothesis, I told that there would be two tail, right tail and left tail. Those would define significant level. So for the two-sided hypothesis testing, we have to come up with one random sample of size n. It might be from any distribution. With a goal is to make inference about the mean of the distribution theta. That theta is unknown to us. We don't know what is the true value of theta. We don't know. So for inference purpose, we are defining two-sided hypothesis. What are those? It is saying that we are having two hypotheses. One hypothesis we are calling it null hypothesis. That means the parameter is, if you are starting with it happens to be by default hypothesis. That means if you try to infer about this theta with this sample, given sample of size n, then in null hypothesis we are taking true value of theta. Like if you're tossing a coin, then what is the true value of success? Probability of success, that one is 0.5. Generally, we start with 0.5 in order to perform hypothesis testing. That is the meaning of null hypothesis. That means theta is observing true value. And what is alternative hypothesis? We try to focus around only this null hypothesis. If we get sufficient evidence to reject this null hypothesis, then simply it signifies that we are going to accept alternative hypothesis. But if the given evidence, that one is coming from sample, if that one is insufficient to reject H naught, then simply we say that we fail to reject H naught. So anyhow, we have to proceed with H naught. So that criteria is coming. So that situations, that's why it is by default a starting hypothesis. And this one is alternative hypothesis. It is coming that theta is not equal to true value. That's here. So we, from everything we try to explain from here, we validate, we take evidence from the sample. So what is that? So here the null hypothesis is simply hypothesis that it is a very simple kind of hypothesis. But the alternative hypothesis here, if you talk about it, is theta is not equal to theta naught. What does it mean? It means that theta might be greater than theta naught. That means greater than, that means theta naught. That means if you talk about tossing a coin, in that case the value of theta in alternative hypothesis might be 0.7, 0.8, 0.9, greater than 0.5. And other scenario would be that either, or it may be possible that value of theta would be less than true value. That means less than 0.5. It might be 0.3, 0.2, 0.1, that kind of situation. So alternative hypothesis is talking about, in this situation, talking about two-sided hypothesis, either theta less than theta naught or theta greater than theta naught. So that's where the corresponding pivot random variable, what we will get, that would be normal, would have approximate standard normal distribution, and we will proceed with two-sided tail, left tail and right tail. So that's way. Otherwise the situation may also come that in some problem, no worry to consider right tail or one of right or left tail. Okay, one of the tail, either you may proceed with just right tail or left tail. That test we will call it one-sided test. So that I will talk later. So here I will take here I told that in order to perform hypothesis testing, you have to come up with one significance level, that alpha level, one value of alpha. Generally value of alpha we are taking either 0.1, 0.2, 0.5, and that kind of situation we are taking. So 0.1, 0.05, that 0.1 means 10%. If you want to consider in percentage. 0.05 means 5%. 0.01 means 1%. So such kind of scenario is there. So a value of alpha might be like these values. Okay, so we have to come up with this one. What kind of level, significant level we want to define? Okay, for a sample, suppose one sample is coming from Gaussian distribution, because we will see that here in case of Gaussian distribution, it is very easy to define pivot element. So that's why we are taking sample from Gaussian distribution, and we are coming with one significant level alpha, and we will try to find a hypothesis. We'll try to infer. So consider we are having a sample of size n, that one is coming from a normal distribution with a known mean theta and known variance sigma square. Okay, theta is unknown and sigma is known. It is given. Okay, then what we have to do? We have to design a significant level alpha. So it is coming from our side. In order to test, to choose hypothesis between H naught and H1. So how we can choose? So in order to choose that, we have to choose, decide. So we have to define. First, we need to define a pivot element. Not it theta, we are defining a pivot element Q. We are defining a pivot element Q. This is Q we are defining, or in order to test these two hypotheses, with which we will our sample will validate, with which our sample will support. That the sample is our evidence. That the evidence we once with given evidence and with desired confidence significant level alpha, which hypothesis we have to validate it, we have to choose it. So for that we are defining a pivot quantity, where x bar is what it is talking about, sample mean, it is one point estimator of a known parameter, mean parameter theta. So we, with the help of that, we are defining a pivot quantity. Now this is first step. We can say that we are defining, first step we are defining hypothesis testing, two-sided hypothesis testing, hypothesis. Afterward we are defining pivot element. This is the pivot element we are defining. In third, we are with the given this alpha, we try to come up with one threshold C. This is the third step. With given alpha, alpha would be always given to you. Either C would be given to you or alpha would be given to you. So with given alpha, we try to find C such that the probability that modulus of Q, it is away original, C away from origin, with given that H naught, that null, by default hypothesis is H naught null hypothesis. So if this probability, we can approximate it by the probability of this probability of a standard normal random variable. Why I told that it is a pivot element, and in large sample size, this Q is approaching to Z, converging in probability to Z. So that's where this probability can be approximated by this one. And we know that if you try to visualize this probability, what does it talk about with the given hypothesis H naught, null hypothesis? And if you try to visualize this one, this property, how you can visualize? So it is like this way. Draw the assumed normal random variable. Then it is talking about this probability of this one. Here, mod of less than alpha. Okay. Less than C, meter call it. Not alpha. Less than C, we want to calculate C. So if you simplify it, what does it talk about? It implies and implied by it says that Z is less than minus C and Z is greater than C. So that means Z is greater than minus Z is greater than C means this point, this area it is talking about, and the value of Z observing after C. Okay, this is the value of Z less than C. That means the value of z which has been observed before c minus. So that's why c is the threshold value. So we can calculate c with the help of given alpha. How we can calculate? We can calculate c as what is this? With this alpha, easily we can say that c is nothing, just it is z alpha by 2. Approximate value of c is z alpha by 2, that we can get it from normal distribution. That inverse of what would be this? If you try to see what would be this, this would be phi inverse of 1 minus alpha by 2. So we can get this value of j threshold value c from normal table. Easily we can get it from them. So therefore, we will accept H naught if after calculating the threshold, it will say that the mod of this pivot quantity, if it is less than this one, this quantity, then we will support this. This would be, we will get here actually with respect to a single sample, we will get one estimate of sample mean, that we can denote it by a small x bar. So we try to validate it for that a small x bar. We will calculate this quantity, one estimate of pivot quantity q, that we will denote it by like this way. Here we are just started with null hypothesis. So here true value of the theta, that will come as a theta naught divided by sigma by n sample size. And we will calculate whether what is the value of this one. If we take modulus, if whether modulus of this one is less than this threshold. If it is less than this, then we will claim that we need to accept. We don't have enough evidence to reject H naught. That means by default we have to accept H naught. So that scenario is coming. Okay. So here the one question I have taken it here. Question is like this way: the average adult male height in a country is 170 meter. This one is. So what is given here? Average is given here. True value of theta naught is given here. That one is 170 centimeter. True value of theta is given. That one is 170. Okay. We suspect that the men in a city in that country might have different average height due to some environmental factors. So we just suspect this one. So we have to test the hypothesis in order to infer about whether we are right or wrong. So so what we do? We proceed with a random sample of size n from the adult male people from that city. We take a sample, random sample of size 9, and we measure the height of those 9 people. So those height are like 176.2, 172, 187.9, 160.1, 180.9, 165.1, 167.2, 162.9, 155.7, 166.2. So these are the height of those 9 people from the random sample of size 9. Okay. So we took a sample, just a sample. So what we will do? We assume that the height distribution in this population is normally distributed. You might have already seen many where that if you talk about distribution of height or distribution of weight in long run of sample size, then it happens to be normally distributed. Okay, approximately normally distributed. So here we need to decide between two hypotheses, whether the null hypothesis is true, or whether we fail to reject null hypothesis or we reject hypothesis. If we are rejecting hypothesis, that means we are supporting alternative hypothesis. That means mean height is, average height is not 170 for that city, for a particular city. Okay, it is not 170. If we are enough evidence with support to reject this one, then we will say that average height of the that city would be not equal to 170. But if you fail to reject this hypothesis, if you fail to reject this null hypothesis, then with this sample, then simply we will say that we are not having enough evidence in order to reject null hypothesis. And so anyhow, we will say that we simply accept H naught, and by saying that average height of the city, average height of the people in that city would be 170 centimeter. That we will say that if we fail to reject H naught, in that case we will say that. So let us proceed here. So based on the observed data, there is enough. We have to check this one. So based on the observed, this is the observation, observed data, what we have observed. So is there enough evidence to reject H naught at significant level 5%? So significant level is also given here. It is 5%. With this significant level or with this observed data, whether we are going to reject H naught or we are going to accept this one, you will see it here. So in order to just apply the hypothesis testing here, I am applying a two-sided here. Simply I am taking in null hypothesis H naught equal theta equal to H naught, that value is given 170, and this one is null hypothesis, and alternative hypothesis is theta is not equal to theta naught. What is the value of theta naught? That one is 170. It is given in the question. Okay, so these two are hypotheses we are starting with. And now here, in order to establish which one is true, so we are having data observed, one observation of the sample mean. So from that we come across to see that sample mean is one estimate of sample mean 165.8 from the given 9 observation. We just solve found the sample mean, one value of the sample mean, it is this one, and one value of the sample standard sample variance, this is, so it will give this value of sample standard deviation, that one is 8.25, because true standard deviation is also not given. Okay, and the sample size is 9. So all these things are given from the question problem. It is given. Now we will try to estimate a pivot quantity from this given quantity. So we define pivot quantity how? We are defining pivot quantity like this way, Q as a standardized normal random variable, as a standardized sample mean, we are defined like this way, and your sample mean x bar is the sample mean, we know that, and one estimate of this sample mean we denote it by a small x bar, and by taking this small x bar and true value of theta, because we are starting by default hypothesis is H naught, then what is the true value of theta? It is equal to 170, sorry. It is equal to 170 from the question, it is given. So using theta naught, using one estimate of sample mean x bar, that happens to be a small x bar, that happens to be 165.8, and corresponding sample standard deviation, so we'll get an approximate value of Q. So it would be what? One approximate, this simply I would like to write here. So one approximate value of Q, it would be what? It would be x bar approximate value minus 170 divided by what is in place of sigma. We don't know, sigma is not given in the question. So we will take one estimate of sigma, that happens to be sample standard deviation divided by a square root of 9. So if you simplify this value, and value of S is already taken here, so we are getting an approximate value of Q, that one is negative 1.2. That one is one estimate of the pivot quantity Q we are getting. So we got one estimate. We will see that whether directly we got it from the sample. Now whether this Q is going to support H naught or whether it is going to reject H naught, so that we will see it. So we will calculate that significant probability that Q is greater than or equal to this Q is what approximately normally distributed. So that's why we are taking this. This is the threshold C. C threshold we are taking, and what is the confidence probability? That is 0.5. And if you simplify, then by simplification from the normal table, the value of Z point alpha by 2, Z alpha by 2, that would be 1.96. And if you see, if you take negative of this one, negative would be negative of 1.96. And from here, easily we can see that this quantity is less than the Q what we got from the observed sample. So this quantity is less than this one. So if you take modulus, simply it is one value of Q. So from this one value of Q, we can here establish that the pivot quantity as a standardized sample mean, it is actually satisfying this threshold criteria that mod of Q is less than 1.96. Then what does it mean? What does it mean? It simply signifies that our hypothesis S naught we fail to reject. Here Q is here in this region, fail to reject. So that's why if you are willing to translate this one in term of what we call it x bar, how we can translate? So replace Q here. So here replace Q by x bar minus 170 by s by a square root of 9. A square root of 9, then easily we will see that this true mean, if you try to see that we can get a threshold of x bar minus 170 true value of this one. That means x bar is near to 170 within this threshold value C dash. I'm writing it C dash. So that's why here we fail to reject H naught. With this given example, we fail to reject H naught. That means true value of the parameter is around 170. It is 170. Okay. Now next I will talk about P value. What is P value? It is also one another kind of measurement. Till now we have already seen that whatever concept is coming, first we have to come up with hypothesis that theta is equal to true value of theta, and alternative hypothesis is theta is not equal to true value of theta. Second, we have to define a pivot quantity. As if we are going to inference about sample mean, then we are defined by pivot quantity like this way. If sigma is given, then we will define this one. If sigma is not given, then from the data itself we can estimate sample, we can compute sample standard deviation, and through that we can define a pivot quantity like this way. In third, we have to find the threshold for Q. We are not finding the threshold for X bar sample mean, we are finding for threshold for Q. So it is very easy to find the threshold for Q, because Q is almost normal random variable, a standard normal random variable. So this probability is given equal to alpha. So here it is approximately normal, so we will replace it by a modulus of Z greater than Z by alpha 2. Here see that threshold value would be Z alpha by 2, and just we can solve it here with the given alpha. Alpha would be always given, we can always find the value of Z alpha by 2 we can always find. So in fourth step, what we have to do, once we got the, this one, then we will see that this implies this, if whether this Q is modulus of Q is less than this quantity or greater than this quantity. If it is greater than this quantity, then we will say that our sample is providing enough evidence to reject H naught. But suppose if we are getting one value of Q that happens to be modulus of that happens to be less than Z alpha by 2, then simply what we have to accept H naught. And acceptance that it is coming from pivot quantity. But if you try to see acceptance from actual quantity, then what you have to do, replace it by sample mean times this one and simplify these. This just you have to simplify this inequality, and after that you will get acceptance or rejection of here it would be after simplification. Again here I tell till now it would be Z alpha by 2, and after simplification you will see that you will get another threshold that would be a function of sigma by square root of n and Z alpha by 2. So that's why I'm putting it C dash. You will get one this kind of situation. If you, in that case, that means your that given sample is supporting H naught hypothesis. If you are getting this kind of situation, otherwise that sample is not supporting. Otherwise, if this quantity is greater than C naught, then we will say that our given sample is not good evidence. It is not supporting the null hypothesis. So we have to go with alternative hypothesis. So here, what is p-value? So first, I would like to define p-value. P-value, it says that it is the lowest significant level that result in rejecting null hypothesis. So you will, when you calculate the value of this one, probability of alpha. If someone is saying that what is alpha, so I had already discussed that alpha is the probability of type 2, type 1 error. That's significant level, type 1 error. Error, what we define. That means we are starting with H naught. But we reject H naught. Reject H naught given that H naught is true. We are rejecting. So if you try to convert this one, what does it mean? Reject, when we are rejecting, that means when simply if I write in term of pivot quantity, then pivot quantity it would be something like that. Rejecting means Q falls in rejection region, that means modulus of Q is greater than Z alpha by 2 or threshold value given H naught true value. This is the way to calculate alpha, that upper value of alpha, upper limit of alpha. And if you are definitely this quantity would be, it would be always less than equal to alpha. We are upper limit of this one, we are saying that it is significant level. And if you try to calculate this value say also you can say that if this value is coming less than alpha, that we can say that it is a p value. Also we are defining this one as p value. And if this value is less than alpha, one what we come up with, alpha generally we come up with, and here it is upper bound of this one. This if this value is less than, then simply we say that this is the lowest significant level that result in rejecting null hypothesis. So that is the situation. That value of p value is coming, suppose alpha you have taken 0.5 and p value that after calculation, in this calculation it is coming 0.04, then what we observe that 0.04 is less than 0.05, then what does it mean? We have to reject the null hypothesis. So that we need to calculate it. So further, if you try to see intuitively, if the p value is small, it means, so simply if you ask why we are calculating p value actually we are calculating from the observed data. Okay, so if p value is small, what does it mean? It means that observed data is very unlikely to have occurred under truthness of H naught. Okay, so we are more confident in rejecting H naught. null hypothesis. So for example, consider just I will elaborate further. Consider a hypothesis test for a choice between H0 or H1, and we are defining a pivot quantity Q, and we are taking one estimate of Q, that we are saying that it is Q1. It is one estimate or one observed value of Q, and we assume that by default we are always start with null hypothesis. We assume that our null hypothesis is true, and if suppose we are calculating p value as a probability of type 1 error, and when the test threshold we are taking this with this estimate of the Q pivot quantity, and here if we see that this value just here, as I told that with by calculating this probability we will get p value. If this p value is less than, if this p value is less than alpha, we are going to reject H0. If this p value is greater than alpha, we fail to reject H0. That situation will come. So that situation, so it is p value is another thresholding measure what we are coming. So one was C kind of things, another is coming like this with p value. So p value directly we are calculating probability of type 1 error from the observed data. So it is all about today's class. In next class we will discuss about one-sided hypothesis testing and few other results. Okay, regarding attendance, just put your